Hello, I'm Ankit Sabharwal, working as a PhD student at CSIR Institute of Genomics and Integrated Biology under Dr. Sridhar Sivasubbu and Dr. Vinod Skaria. Today I'll be giving a talk on the nuclear mitochondrial crosstalk and what implications does it have in the mitochondrial function and the disease pathophysiology. The mitochondrial disorders are so prevalent that there are even comic books written on them. This is an example of one comic book like Mighty Mito Superhero written by Mackenzie Laurie, a 9-year-old girl, for her 6-year-old younger brother, Galvin, who suffered from mitochondrial disorders. Unfortunately, the prevalence of mitochondrial disorder is 1 in 5,000 live births. The first case of mitochondrial disorder was reported as Luft disease in 1958, and later on, various mitochondrial disorders have been characterized, such as the Lund disease due to mutations in ND4 gene, and leak disease due to mutation in SDH1 gene. The mitochondrial genome only comprises of 37 genes and it is roughly 16.5 kb in size. Is it sufficient for a genome of 16.5 kb to code or to be responsible for so many disorders associated with it? The answer is no. Due to technical advancements in the proteomics as well as the sequencing technologies, we have seen a rise in the contributing factor responsible for the mitochondrial disorders. Now, till date, there are about 200 mitochondrial mutations known and about 70 mitochondrial disorders for which the etiology has not been known till date. Now, let us peek into this robust factory of the cell that is also known as the powerhouse of the cell. The mitochondria is a double membrane-bound organelle that is found in almost all eukaryotic cells. The outer membrane consists of about special channels for transporting molecules. The inner membrane has the machinery for the oxidative phosphorylation, and the matrix contains the mitochondrial enzymes, the TCA cycle enzymes, and the DNA. Now, the mitochondria is a semi-autonomous organelle. That means though it has a genome of its own, but it is dependent on the nuclear genome for various functions. And it has originated from alpha proteobacterial ancestral, that is Rickettsia prosecki, and is also known as the powerhouse of the cell since it makes ATP, that is also known as the energy currency of the cell. Now, what is mitochondrial genome? The mitochondrial genome is roughly of 16.5 kb in humans, whereas in zebrafish and other model organisms, it is roughly of 16.9 kb. The mitochondrial genome encodes about for 37 genes, out of which 13 are only protein coding genes responsible for the oxidative phosphorylation, whereas the 22 genes encode for the tRNAs and the 2 are ribosomal RNA genes. The mitochondrial genome does not have any introns and there is only one non-coding region, that is the D-loop region, and all that contains the origin of replication. The mitochondria genome contains about two strands, that is heavy strand and the light strand. And one thing to be pointed out here is that codon usage. The codon usage for both the nuclear genome and the mitochondrial genome is different. For example, UGA, whereas it codes for tryptophan according to mitochondrial codon usage, and it is a stop codon as per the nuclear codon usage. The gene order, strand-specific nucleotide bias, and the codon usage is conserved across all species. Mitochondrial genome is maternally inherited, barring few exceptions. Now, what happens when there is a mutation in this mitochondrial genome or the mitochondria is dysfunctional? There is a broad spectrum of mitochondrial disorders associated with it, ranging from very common clinical manifestations such as anemia, diabetes, renal failure, to as complex as microcephaly, optic neuropathy, retinopathy, and stroke, ataxia, etc. So defining these mitochondrial disorders is they are a result of either inherited or spontaneous mutations in nuclear DNA or mitochondrial DNA leading to altered functions of mitochondria. The one question that comes in front of us is what makes this mitochondrial disorder so difficult to diagnose? Because the answer is because of these wide clinical manifestations. The first thing that a clinician sees in a patient is, are two organs, different organs, unrelated, affected or not in a patient? And then he goes towards a clinical criteria that is also known as a Nijmegen clinical criteria for diagnosing mitochondrial disorders. On the chart provided, you can see that there are various symptoms associated with particular points. For example, taking a case, hereby a clinician will see whether there is an accumulation of pyruvate or lactate in the patient. Now, if there is an elevated fluid lactate or alanine in the patient's cerebrospinal fluid, the clinician will give 2 points to them. Then he will see for exercise intolerance or muscle weakness and then give 1 point each for that. He will go for elevated blood lactate or RAD-RED fibers on muscle biopsy and then he will give another 2 points. Now, adding all these points on this as per this criteria, the clinician will arrive at a particular point. Now, if the points are above 8, it is known as a definitive mitochondrial disorder. If it is between 5 to 7, it's a probable mitochondrial disorder. If it is 2 to 4, between 2 to 4, it's a possible mitochondrial disorder. And if it is only 1 point, it is unlikely to be a mitochondrial disorder. Now, how these mitochondrial disorders are inherited? As I said, that the mutations in mitochondrial DNA also lead to mitochondrial disorders, and therefore, since the mitochondrial genome is maternally inherited, therefore disorders are maternally inherited, and the clinical manifestations depends on the threshold of the levels of mutant mitochondrial DNA copy. Here in this diagram, I'll explain you the genetic bottleneck that is associated with this mitochondrial disorders and the heteroplasmy. Now, for example, you can see a primordial germ cell that is containing mutant mitochondrial DNA copy as well as the wild-type mitochondrial copy. Now, before that, I'll stress on the fact that a cell contains multiple copies of mitochondria and one mitochondrion contains multiple copies of mitochondrial DNA. Now, this primordial germ cell upon oocyte maturation and amplification will, after fertilization, will have multiple copies of mitochondrial DNA. Now let's see first case where only the wild-type mitochondrial DNA copies have multiplied and there is then after fertilization there will be no mutation and the offspring will be unaffected. So this is the case of homoplasmy. Homoplasmy meaning only one type of mitochondrial DNA copy present in one mitochondrion. Now let's see the second case where 80% of the mitochondrial DNA copies are wild type and only 20% of them is the mutated mitochondrial DNA copy. Now upon maturation and amplification, there will be a low level of mutation and the offspring can be mildly affected. Thus heteroplasmy, because different types of copies of mitochondrial DNA are present. The third case is much more severe, where about 80% of the mitochondrial DNA copies are mutated and only 20% is wild type. Now the clinical manifestation will be much severe and the offspring is likely to be affected. Another case of heteroplasmy. Now heteroplasmy also depends on the tissue's energy demand, whereas the tissues with extensive energy demand such as brain, liver, heart may exhibit clinical manifestation with heteroplasmy levels as low as 25%. But certain tissues which have very less energy demand like blood and kidney may not exhibit clinical manifestations even up to 30%. Now, another set of mitochondrial disorders are encoded by the nuclear genes and they show Mendelian inheritance and are autosomal recessive. Now, as I said, how to diagnose a clinical mitochondrial disorder on the basis of heteroplasmy? So there's a very clean, very beautiful pipeline developed as Mitomatic in our lab that actually detects my heteroplasmy levels as low as up to 10%. So what happens in this pipeline is the blood is collected from the patients and the mitochondrial genome is isolated from them. So it is a PCR based strategy whereby using only three long primers, we amplify the entire 16.5 kb in the way of three contigs, overlapping contigs, and then these overlapping contigs are actually sequenced at a very high coverage using an NGS platform. Why very high coverage? Because to resolve heteroplasmy levels as low as 10% and to be sure that the variants that we are calling or the heteroplasmy levels that we are calling can lead to clinical manifestations or not. Now the data generated is fed into an automated bioinformatic analysis pipeline using a Mitomatic pipeline, and then at the end we get a clinical report that can be easily accessed by a clinicians or any other researcher. Recently, this technology was transferred to Eurofins and is now known as MitoSure. Now, telling here, I'll take a small detour towards two families that were presented to one of our collaborators, Professor Bahik Shahata and Dr. Greg Gibson from Emory University and Georgia Tech. So here there are two families in which the father, mother and the sibling were unaffected, but the daughter was affected. Both these cases died in infancy and the clinical diagnosis proved that it was a rare arrhythmogenic disorder And the pathological findings from autopsies pointed towards excessive development of Purkinje fibers. There was a myocardial thickening associated with it, and the cardiomegaly, that is the enlargement of the chamber of heart. The cytological findings of histocytoid myocytes also revealed that there was excessive and abnormal mitochondria. There was glycogen and lipid accumulation, and reduced myofibrils and decreased intercellular gap. Now, previously, with these clinical-like symptoms, there have been two genes associated with it. That was the mitochondrial CEP gene and the mitochondrial TK gene have been earlier reported with this defect. But subsequent studies on these patients and other patients failed to point out the role of mitochondrial encoded proteins or genes associated with this disorder. Therefore, our hypothesis was based on the fact that can the mutations responsible for this disorder lie in the nuclear compartment or not. Until date, the cardiac etiology is not fully understood for these diseases. Now, before that, why these nuclear encoded genes are actually important for the mitochondrial function? Now, there is a crosstalk that is taking place between the nuclear genome and the mitochondria. The DNA encodes for transcribes RNA, and from RNA, translation takes place of a protein that is actually transported or imported, I should say, in mitochondria. Thereby, it performs a wide variety of functions such as oxidative phosphorylation subunits like NDUFB11, mitochondrial DNA maintenance and expression like Pinkel protein, membrane dynamics like and composition like mitoferrin, nucleotide transport and synthesis like SLCA25, or oxidative phosphorylation biogenesis and regulations like NDUFAF2. Now, there was a very elaborate study done by Mota and his group from Broad Institute that actually compiled and created a database that actually catalogs about 1100 odd nuclear encoded proteins that are imported into mitochondrial database. Now, what happens when there is a miscommunication between these in this crosstalk? Now, there can be a mutation in the genomic DNA, or there the RNA might be degraded, or there can be an impairment of this protein inside the mitochondria. Now, what happens when this takes place is there are a lot of clinical manifestations associated with it that are actually caused by various mitochondrial defects, such as the respiratory chain complex inhibition, increased loss levels that leads to actually mitochondrial deletions, decreased ATP levels, decreased calcium buffering capacity, and impaired mitochondrial protein import. Now, having said this, I'll come back again to that clinical study, case study that I earlier talked about, and now about those two families in which the daughter was said to be suffering from a rare arrhythmogenic disorder. So what our collaborators did at Georgia Tech was they did a whole exome analysis, a sequencing of these two patients, and the exome analysis revealed mutations in the chromosome X in the gene NDUFB11 in the second exon. And till date, the role of NDUFB11 in understanding the cardiac function has not been fully understood. So to understand the role, so to summarize that, the whole exome analysis identified mutations in families suffering from histocytoid cardiomyopathy, revealing two de novo nonsense mutations in the second exons of NDUFB11. Since the role of this gene in the cardiac biology was not known, we tried modeling it in the model organism zebrafish. So before that, what does this gene does? So this gene is NDH dehydrogenase, ubiquinone beta 1 beta subcomplex 11. It is present on the X chromosome, thereby showing that Y females were said to be affected, and Y males having one copy, maybe because of mutation in this gene, were associated with miscarriage. Now, this function gene is actually a component of mitochondrial complex 1, that is an accessory subunit of mitochondrial membrane respiratory chain NDH dehydrogenase, and is responsible for the transfer of electrons from NDH to respiratory chain. Now, as I said, to model this disorder, to phenocopy this defect, cardiac defect in zebrafish, we actually use zebrafish as a model organism. And zebrafish in past has been used to study mitochondrial disorders. And this gene is actually present on the chromosome 8. And there is a 45% protein conservation between this protein at the human and the zebrafish at the sequence level. So what we did? We adopted a morpholino-based gene knockdown approach, where we inject morpholino in a single-cell zebrafish embryo, and we observed for the cardiac phenotype. On the figure panel, you can see there are NIC as well as the NDUFB11 ATG morpholino 1 and 2, we injected a cocktail of 280G morpholinos, and you can see on the diagram on the slide that there's a 72 HPF transgenic CNLC2 MRP zebrafish embryos showing a cardiac phenotype, a defect. At the 72 HPF, the atrium and the ventricles somehow overlap, and but in the mutants you can see that the overlapping has not taken place, and we could see distinct atrial and ventricle chambers. So it will be more clear in this video, where you can see the atrium and ventricle overlapped and the proper cardiac defect formed in the non-injected control animal, whereas the looping has not taken place in the NDUFB11 morphine, and the atrial and ventricle chambers are very discrete. So our study pointed out that knockdown of NDUFB11 in zebrafish embryos results in cardiac looping defects, and the zebrafish heart fails to loop, possibly highlighting the role of this gene in the looping morphogenesis. Now, to conclude this story, we could say that the whole exome analysis identified two de novo nonsense mutations in exon 2 of NDUFB11 gene, the gene responsible for the complex 1 of electron transport chain. The knockdown of this gene actually resulted in the looping defect of the heart. The zebrafish heart possibly failed to loop, possibly highlighting the role of this gene in the looping morphogenesis. Currently, we are investigating the role of this gene in the etiology of this disease. Having said that, there are a few take-home messages that needs to be kept in our mind about mitochondrial disorders. One thing is that mitochondrial disorders are not only maternally inherited, so therefore the nuclear encoded function also needs to be taken care of. There are nuclear encoded genes that are responsible for mitochondrial disorders, and therefore the screening for mitochondrial disorders should not be only limited to mitochondrial genome sequencing, whereas it should also go further, and the exome analysis should also be done for these patients who are said to be suffer from the putative mitochondrial disorder. Having said that, I'd like to acknowledge the Guardian Consortium, my collaborators, Dr. Professor Bahik Shahata from Emory University, Dr. Greg Gibson from Georgia Tech, and 70 odd clinicians, and my guide, Dr. Sridhar Sivasubhu and Dr. Vinod Skarian, and also funding from the CSIR CardioMed Project PSC 0122. Hope you enjoyed this talk. Thanks a lot.